This is FYI News 13, brought to you by SSPTV and the Hazleton Standard Speaker.
For your information, it's beginning to look a lot like fall, and we have a special guide to local fall foliage next. Welcome one and all, and thank you for watching. My name is Ken Carr, and my job is to provide you with local information from FYI and the Hazleton Standard Speaker. A first-of-its-kind drug and alcohol expo will take place tomorrow night in the Hazleton area. This free event is being sponsored by State Representative Tara Tuhill and hosted by Pathway to Recovery Counseling and Educational Services in Hazleton. It will feature local agencies and activities. A mock teen bedroom will be on display to show parents how drugs can be hidden in plain sight. There will also be Narcan training at 6:30 p.m. Participants will learn how to administer the drug naloxone, which can save the person experiencing an opiate overdose. Tomorrow's free drug and alcohol expo is from 6 till 8 p.m. at the Hazleton Area Career Center. The public is encouraged to attend. Meanwhile, Pennsylvania Governor Tom Wolf will address the House and the Senate in a joint session tomorrow, and the focus will be taking action to combat opioid and heroin crisis.
With 10 people a day dying from drug overdoses in our Commonwealth, we cannot afford to stall. Through legislation, we should require prescribers to check the prescription drug monitoring database every time they prescribe opioids and limit the opioid quantities that emergency room patients can be prescribed at any one time. We also need laws that require medical professionals to receive updated education about opioids and pain management. We should require public school students to be taught about opioid misuse. Legislation is needed to require insurance carriers to make abuse deterrent opioids more affordable and to establish a voluntary directive for patients who don't want to be prescribed opioids. After consultation with legislative leaders, I believe we can make a profound impact by working together this fall to combat the opioid and heroin epidemic in our Commonwealth.
The governor will address the House and Senate tomorrow. You can watch it tomorrow at 11:30 a.m. on Facebook Live. Log on to facebook.com/governorwolf. Funeral arrangements have been set for a well-known Hazleton entrepreneur. 82-year-old Louis J. Booty Beltrami passed away on Sunday. His funeral will be held on Thursday at 10 a.m. at the Farrell Funeral Home in Hazleton, followed by a mass of Christian burial at 11 a.m. at Good Shepherd Church in Drums. Friends may call tomorrow from 3 until 8 p.m. at the funeral home. In lieu of flowers, the family would appreciate a memorial gift in his honor to United Charities, Catholic or Catholic Social Services, Good Shepherd Church, or any charitable organization dedicated to educating people about the dangers of smoking. A member of the SSPTV family is being honored. Congratulations to our Ron Marchetti for being named the 2016 Columbus Day Outstanding Italian American. Marchetti is a well-known fourth-generation plumber in the Hazleton area. He's also the host of Trivia Treats and Short Shots, seen each week right here on FYI, two features he has been doing for more than 20 years. Among his many past honors, Ron was presented with the Ray Saul Sports Legend Award in 2009 and was honored as Hazleton Elk of the Year in 2011. He was inducted into the Hazleton Area Sports Hall of Fame in 2012 and the Luzerne County Sports Hall of Fame in 2015. Ronnie also served in the U.S. Army. Marchetti and his wife Chris celebrated their 54th anniversary in April. They have four children, Lisa, Robin, Terry, and Randy, and seven grandchildren. Ronnie remains partially active, helping his son operate the family business, R.L. Marchetti Plumbing. Ron Marchetti is one of the nicest and most humble people in the world. And while he is totally embarrassed by the praise, we congratulate him on this special honor. Ronnie will be recognized during a dinner Sunday, October 9th at 6 p.m. at Capriotti's in McAdoo. Tickets are $35. For tickets or to place an ad in the program, call 570-956-1532. We're already halfway through the 161st annual Bloomsburg Fair. This year offers some new attractions like this interesting piece of history. You're going to see the tanks. Here's Fair President Paul Reichert.
There's a couple strolling groups that's coming and they'll be in the fairgrounds all over the place. The Stewie tank that was built in Berwick is here, will be here this year. And I think that's another plus because so many people worked at the AC&F during the World War II, and we do have a Stewie tank of becoming.
The fair continues through Saturday. For tickets and information, go to bloomsburgfair.com. Fair week means that the beautiful changing leaves are not far behind. Lisa Sugart has more on this special time of year.
Well, it is a beautiful time of the year when we're all looking forward to the leaves changing into beautiful colors and making it look very picturesque throughout the entire state of Pennsylvania. And one man that pays close attention to all of that is Tim Latz. He is a forester with the Department of Conservation and Natural Resources. So glad you literally traveled an hour to get to our studios today to tell us all about the fall foliage. And I guess one question we want to know before we see all those pretty colors is, how does it happen? So what determines whether we have a very colorful year or not?
So most of your colors determined by how much drought we've had this summer and about how cold it's been every night in the fall. Really kind of determines what's going to change and when it's going to change.
So this year, we've been hearing a lot about drought. So what does that have, a positive or negative impact?
It's actually going to increase the amount of species that are changing, and it's going to increase the schedule of when they change. So your peak fall color will actually be moved up. It could be even as much as a week.
So for our area, our viewers are mainly Luzerne County, Schuylkill County. What do we expect to see locally in our area? When do you think we'd see our peak?
I would say your peak fall foliage is going to be still around Columbus Day. The drought was bad, but most of our species here in Luzerne County, Schuylkill County, are oak. So they typically handle drought fairly well, and so they should be okay. So expect fall foliage around October 16th.
Alrighty, but we have to pay attention to see if the weather gets really cold then. So when the cold, that impacts it in what way?
That'll also increase when peak fall foliage will be. So far we've been pretty normal with how cold it's been on average. So I would expect that it's not gonna have too much of an impact.
Now, a lot of people travel into Pennsylvania or into other areas to see the beautiful fall foliage. So there's a place where they can go to find out more about it. There's a website.
Absolutely. So if you just go to DCNR's website, there's a segment, whole segment on fall foliage, and it's broken out by areas of Pennsylvania. There's the Northeast, the Southeast, Southwest, Northwest. And it'll give you a lot of areas to go see the fall foliage, a lot of parks and state forests and roads if you just want to drive through nice areas.
This is a big state for it, so a lot of people do come here specifically for that.
Yeah, that's right. We have an extremely diverse forest system with a lot of different species. And because we have those different species, almost all of them have a different shade of color. There's three or four different shades of yellow. It's not just one color, it's many, many different colors, and they all are changing colors at different times, so our fall season's very, very long, which is why it draws in so many people from so many areas.
Well, good to know. And if you want to know where the leaves will be changing, please go to the website for DCNR and check it out. And be sure to enjoy all this beauty this fall right here in our own backyard.
Coming up next, more information from the Hazleton Area School District Superintendent Dr. Craig Butler. And in sports, we check in with the Penn State Hazleton men's soccer team during a season of change and so far, success.
This is FYI News 13, brought to you by SSPTV and the Hazleton Standard Speaker.
local organization dedicated to helping children in foster care find their forever home has received a prestigious award. Congressman Lou Barletta recently presented the Angels in Adoption Award to the founders of Brandon's Forever Home in Hazleton. The presentation was made in Washington, D.C. The award, presented by the Congressional Coalition on Adoption Institute, is given to individuals or organizations nationwide and is considered prestigious in the world of adoption and foster care. Brandon's Forever Home was founded in 2014 by State Representative Tara Tuhill and local attorney Lori Ogurkis, who each had personal experiences with adoption and foster care. You can learn more about the organization at brandonsforeverhome.com.
Time now for FYI News 13 weather.
The sun made a comeback today. Hi there, friend. Will you be around tomorrow? Let's see. Here's a local forecast from the National Weather Service. Tonight, mostly clear. Our low will be 48 degrees. We'll have a light and variable wind. Wednesday, 20% chance of showers after 3 p.m. with some increasing clouds. We'll have a high near 68 degrees. Wednesday night, showers likely mainly after 3 a.m. Cloudy with a low of 55. New precipitation amounts between a half and three quarters of an inch possible. Thursday, showers likely once again. Cloudy with a high near 63. Thursday night, 60% chance of showers. Cloudy with a low of 56. Friday, 50% chance of showers, mostly cloudy, high in the mid-60s. Friday night, we dip down to a 40% chance of showers, mostly cloudy, low of 54 degrees. On Saturday, 40% chance of showers, partly sunny day with a high in the mid-60s again. And then Saturday night, 30% chance of showers, mostly cloudy, low of 53 degrees.
I'm pleased to welcome Dr. Craig Butler, the superintendent of the Hazleton Area School District, today to talk about cooperative education. It's a co-op program, school to work. Students who go to class, but they also have a job. And this has been a program in the district for many years, but now it's new and improved, I guess we could say, Dr. Butler.
That's correct, Lisa. Thanks to the support of our school directors, the program has expanded this year. Mr. Larry DiBello, who has been in charge of the program in the past, has had basically a quarter of his day dedicated to the program, and through a decision-making process with our director of our career center, Lori Herman, and the school directors, that program's been expanded now, where Larry devotes half of his schedule each day to the program. The program is very exciting, Lisa. As you say, it's a school-to-work program. It immerses our seniors, primarily those students who are meeting graduation credits and are good academic standing. They're embedded and immersed into the community in positions where they're paid, essentially a paid internship. It's in their vocation, their trade that they're interested in. It's such a powerful transition program from the school to the work environment, just a great training ground for our students, opportunity to earn money for our graduating seniors, and the program is will serve the community well in terms of many of our businesses, local businesses, look forward to employing our students. They appreciate the extra help. Hopefully they appreciate the skills that our students bring to the workplace.
I would think for the businesses, it's a very big plus as well, because they're training someone and then maybe they're hiring that person. So they know that they're getting the training they need to do the job should they be hired then upon graduation.
It's very interesting you bring that up. Larry and I were talking just the other day about a number of our students get into that setting, into this internship experience, and they like it so much that, and this is a good thing, they stay in our community. They have a good solid opportunity to work in a good paying job. We see our graduates staying local. That's very important. And oftentimes it turns into a very lucrative situation for them individually, and they become a contributing citizen of the community. They stay here locally, and they're learning about adult life, so to speak.
What is the recommended age of a student and the parent who maybe ask about this program? Because you don't want to wait till the last minute, obviously. So should they be doing it early on in their high school career?
Well, we're definitely focusing on seniors at this point, Lisa. But in speaking with Larry recently, we will entertain interest from a junior as well. But again, the students must be in good academic standing. There shouldn't be any question about the fact that they're going to
meet or exceed their graduation requirements, which really, if a student puts their, you know, the nail to the board, so to speak, and works hard, there should be no question with the number of opportunities we have at them meeting graduation requirements. So it's a matter of them being serious and committed, ready to go into the workforce and be a good representative of the school system, but also be an asset to that business.
All right, well, hopefully we brought some important information to some parents and students that may be interested in taking part in that in the future, an expanded co-op program for the Hazleton Area Career Center.
Thank you, Lisa. Now here's our home of the week from the beautiful Eagle Rock Resort. It's a cozy ranch with 3 bedrooms and 3 baths, finished basement with a bar, large living room with 2 glass sliding doors to take advantage of a great view of the mountains and ski slopes. It comes fully furnished for $165,000. If you're interested, contact Paul for more information. When we come back on FYI, I have sports. Right now, it's our midday winning Pennsylvania Lottery. Pick 2, 2-0, pick 3, 4-1-7, pick 4, 8-0-7-8, and pick 5, 5-4-1-5-9. Again, sports is next. We'll be right back.
This is FYI News 13 Sports.
The latest FIFA video game comes out today. It will not include the Penn State University Athletic Conference. However, I think some of the Penn State Hazleton players should be available in the Ultimate Team mode. Check out the 2016 Lions story and some of their moves. Penn State Hazleton lost over the weekend to NCAA Division III school Delaware Valley University. The final score was 1-0. That's okay, because the local Lions aren't the 1972 Miami Dolphins, who went 17-0, and their head coach doesn't want them to be.
I'm not a fan of undefeated seasons or anything like that, because I want the guys and the team to understand what it is to lose and how to accept losing, you know. I think that it's an important part of developing as an individual and as a team, is being able to lose and taking things from that loss, not just understanding the scoreline.
The Nittany Lions are 3-1 in the Penn State University Athletic Conference, and they close their regular season with first place PSU Brandywine. An earlier loss to Penn State Beaver should have them ready for that game and the PSU AC playoffs.
The biggest thing we learned from Penn State Beaver is we can't underestimate any team. We came out this year because we have a good squad, and I think we went out a little too confident in the beginning of that game, and it kind of got the best of us. The main thing we got to take away from of all of these games, whether they're wins or losses, is we just got to work hard in practice and take every team as the same. We can't underestimate. That's our biggest problem this year.
As for their non-conference loss to Delaware Valley,
we had a mistake that cost us a goal. But for 90 minutes, I think we were the aggressor, and we really put them on their heels. I don't think they really expected us to be as good as we were. We were trying out a new formation and, you know, some new guys and new positions. So. Kind of the perfect storm for us to not be as successful as we could have been, but I think we came away with a lot more than just a result not going in our favor. We came away with some information that we can use going forward.
Sophomore defender Tyler Wiley explains the change to a 4-3-3 formation with 4 defenders, 3 midfielders, and 3 forwards.
It's just so we can have a little bit more possession in the midfield and have a little bit more of a defensive presence there. We were losing balls there and losing possession, 50-50 balls, and that just helps us to gain more possession there.
With the new formation, senior Kyle Venditti, who leads the team in goals and assists, will slide back from forward to center mid to help facilitate a little bit more. Here he talks more about the formation change.
We have a lot of talented kids this year, can play a lot of different positions, and that's what we're doing right now with the 4-3-3. We're kind of feeling out where everybody can play.
It's been a season of change for the Nittany Lions. Across the field from them, the new women's team practices. Jesse Shadle is also their coach, and he runs back and forth between teams during the times when practices overlap. It may have been easier last year when some of the girls were part of the men's team, but it seems like everyone agrees the new program is a very good thing.
It's nice to see that they have their own squad. You know, they were frustrated last year, and I think I would have been too. But it's nice to have them here, moral support. They're probably our best fan base at the games. I mean, they're on the sidelines cheering us on louder than anybody else. So it's nice to have that moral support from them, too.
The Lions' home field on campus is being renovated, so they've been practicing and playing games at Community Park in Hazel Township. Considering all of the changes, it's been a pretty smooth ride for the Nittany Lions. They've had some losses, but they seem like they have learned from them, and now it's time to put their knowledge to the test as the calendar flips to October and they enter the stretch run. On Thursday, we'll switch sides of the field and talk with members of the women's soccer team at Penn State Hazleton. We have one more thing to do during the sportscast, and that's the FYI Standard Speaker Scoreboard. Let's take a look at what happened. Albert McFadden of Marion, he won the Schuylkill Golf Championship. We'll interview him hopefully later this week or next week. The Penn State Hazleton golf team, they finished third at a tournament recently. Their golfer, John Haley, tied for second. The Hazleton area girls tennis team handed Holy Redeemer their first loss of the season. The Lady Cougars are 11-1 with one match left against Wyoming area on Wednesday. A goal by Hazleton area's Jill Bookman even the score with Crestwood and field hockey, but the Lady Comets scored just about 2 minutes later to get the win. MMI beat Hanover in golf with Doug Giannetti taking medal honors by shooting a 45. The Lady Preppers lost in volleyball to Hanover area in five sets. It was a close one. Dana Corrado had 19 kills for MMI. The Cubs hit the 100 mark on Monday, winning their 100th game by beating the Pirates by 10 runs. Finally, here's a cool note. The Hazleton area boys water polo team, they won a flight championship at the Beast of the East tournament. They beat three teams to win the school's first flight championship ever. Well, my friends, we've come to the end of the sports road, but there's more FYI coming up. Stop in Bottlenecks on Tuesday for their traditional bone-in wing night. 50 cents a wing. Add a small order of fries for only $1.50.
Good evening, everyone, and here's tonight's Talk of the Town report. First tonight, the MPB Community Players 25th Annual Fall Musical is a tribute to two of the most important figures in American theater. Some Enchanted Evening, the Songs of Rodgers and Hammerstein, will be presented this Friday, Saturday, and Sunday at Catholic Social Services in Hazleton. The show features 22 performers from age 10 through 87. Seating is limited, so reservations are recommended. For more information, please call 570-454-0178. And finally, Beaver Meadows Volunteer Fire Company and the Citizens for Recreation will be hosting a Fire EMS Day on Sunday, October 9th from 1 to 3 p.m. at the baseball field to promote fire prevention. A variety of fire and EMS vehicles will be on display, and including a medevac helicopter and the Fire Safety House. That's tonight's Talk of the Town. News 13 would like to send sincere condolences to the family and friends of these recently departed. Louis J. Booty Beltrami of Drums. Funeral is Thursday at 10 a.m. from the Firo Funeral Home. Friends may call Wednesday from 3 to 8 p.m. Dr. Richard T. Buskowski of Eagle Rock. Arrangements will be announced by the Harmon Funeral Home. Agnes May Smith, formerly of Drums. Services Sunday at noon at the St. Paul's United Methodist Church. Teresa C. Yanosky, formerly of Hazleton, services Thursday at 11 a.m. at the Joseph B. Conahan Funeral Home. Friends may call Thursday from 10 to 11 a.m. Carl L. Podlesny of Hazleton, masses Thursday at 9:30 a.m. from the Queen of Heaven Parish at Our Lady of Grace Church. There will be no public viewing. Arrangements are under the direction of the Frank J. Bonin Funeral Home. And Joseph A. Fudge of McAdoo. Private services will be held at the convenience of the family and under the direction of the Damiano Funeral Home. Attention pay-per-view subscribers, if you see your name right now on News 13, you'll have 13 minutes to call in and win a free movie from Service Electric Cablevision. Our winner tonight is Joseph Bones of Barnesville. Joseph, if you're watching, give us a call, 570-455-7267, extension 104.
If you didn't get your gyro from the Bloomsburg Fair yet, what are you waiting for? Get out there. Time is running out. Have fun. We'll be back here tomorrow. Take it easy, everyone.